Hi everybody, welcome to this video. We're going to be talking today about Pythonista's experience learning Go. So I'm Francesc and Brian. I'm a developer programs engineer for the Go team at Google in Mountain View.
And I'm Brian Dorsey. I'm also a developer programs engineer, but I'm on cloud and don't actually have much experience with Go.
Okay, so you decided to learn Go some months ago.
Yep.
What brought you to that decision?
Gotcha. So I've been using Python for a long time. I love it. But there's a few areas where I think, in particular, like distributing command line apps and So in particular, like that was the one thing that I was kind of really looking around for. And I was kind of looking around at languages, and Go looked really, really interesting. And in particular, like having a real baked-in concurrency model was really appealing, because I have to admit I fear threads.
Threads are are difficult to understand sometimes. Yes. Yep. So in a more generic question, why good at Pythonista learn Go?
Right. So definitely, as I mentioned, the concurrency model is really appealing, and there's a lot of different options in the Python world for dealing with concurrency. Both within one process and multi-process and async and all this other kind of stuff. And pretty much every model is possible. But I think it's really nice in Go where there's one way to do it that's baked in, and it's a lot easier to get your head around it, I think, because of that. So that's one thing. And then, of course, you've got a compiled language that's, fast. It feels, honestly, kind of like a Pythonic C to me, like as a Python person. And the approach to object orientation through, what kind of feels like duck typing to me is pretty awesome.
Yes. So, yeah, maybe it feels like duck typing. Go doesn't have duck typing, though.
Okay.
Duck typing is something that, as you very, very well know from Python, it's when if it looks like a duck and quacks like a duck, then it's a duck.
Right.
And if it's not a duck, it will fail at runtime.
Right.
In Go, it will actually fail at compilation time.
So
it's not duck typing, it's called structural subtyping.
Okay.
And it's kind of like if you had an explicit statically checked duck typing.
Okay.
Yes.
Right. So probably that's a better way to think about it. So I guess a good example for Python people might be, we have something that we'll say this object is file-like, right? So you can kind of you can read from it and you can write to it and that sort of thing. But the list of exactly which methods, can you also open it or close it or can you seek on it or things like that, like which ones are actually included in that is not clearly defined all the time. And in Go, you might have an interface that is like you do have an interface that's the read-writer, right?
Yeah, there's reader, there's writer, there's read-writer. And
gotcha.
Also, you were saying seek. So there's read-seeker.
OK. Yes. And so each one of those is a specific collection of methods with their exact signature, right?
Yes.
And so like the compiler can know exactly where
it's. Yes, and then you can write a function that receives as an argument a read-writer, and you know exactly what you can do on that on that object. You can do read and write.
Yes. Right. So locally you're reading the code and you can tell what it can do. So that's awesome.
Yeah, that's great. So now that you've been programming for how long have you been programming?
I basically did a learning project for a couple of months.
Okay.
So not a huge amount of experience, but made one
okay.
Real
so,
project.
But after this couple of months,
yep.
What were the things that surprised you the most?
So I think probably the biggest surprise is error handling,
and
I feel like I got surprised by that twice. One in that I kind of had this initial reaction of wait, this is like the modern world. Why am I like having to deal with the error from every single call, right?
Yes.
And pretty much anything where there's something that can go wrong, and it's software, so things can almost always
everything can go wrong. Yes.
You get this error thing back from, from the call, and you have to deal with it locally. And that really surprised me. And then I feel like working through an actual project with it, I came to really, really like that. So take networking as an example. Hmm. You're going to open a socket and try to do some stuff with it. And there's so many things that can go wrong there.
Yes, everything.
And in it's kind of unclear looking at a local piece of Python socket code whether, you know, which errors are handled, right? Because it could be handled locally, it could be handled in a wrapped exception somewhere. Like, you have to kind of know the whole code base to know where that's at. And in Go, it's right there in front of you on the screen page you're looking at.
Yes.
And, you know, of course you can decide, well, if anything goes wrong, then I just have to abort because I can't continue. But it'll be written right there. And if you want to handle all of the various corner cases, then that's also kind of laid out right there in front of you. So I've come to feel like the error handling is very powerful. And I almost feel uncomfortable without being able to see it in front of me.
So the thing that now when you write Python code, do you write kind of Go style error handling in Python or not really?
I'm a little more careful about the errors that I consider up front. You know, my tendency in the past has been to just kind of write it and then bang on it and, oh, okay, that happened.
Everything that is failing.
Yeah, exactly. You know, and then, you know, you don't.
I used to do that too.
Yeah, still do. But, and, you know, I think that's kind of the way to go. You know, like you want to have a test suite that, you know, covers all of your cases. But I guess I feel like, you know, it takes me,
Yeah, so do you think that, therefore, since you're writing all this extra code for handling errors, do you think that's a good thing, that's a bad thing, it takes you longer, is it worth it?
It's absolutely worth it. And I feel like, so yes, it takes me longer. Part of that's because I don't know Go as well.
Okay, but, fair enough.
But also I think it just takes me longer to work through the logic of it. And overall, I feel like that's actually a good thing. You know, I feel like, you know, it takes me longer to work through this flow and the cases that I need to handle, and I feel more confident in the result.
Okay, that's good.
Yeah.
So now that you are almost a Go expert already,
2 months of
what could be your advice to people that probably Pythonistas that are curious about Go? What could be your piece of advice for
them? So the main thing I think would be, one, try it. It's absolutely worth your time to learn Go because you will get the ability to use a new language that complements Python really well. But also, the tooling around Go really helps you, like from a software engineering standpoint, write good code more quickly, faster. There's a whole bunch of things in that area you can read about. But it's really true. And getting in the habit there, I think, helps your habits writing Python code as well. Yes. So, I mean, we can do all the same things in the Python world. We just have, you know, dozens of different options for each of them. So I think it's helpful to have kind of this one path and get in the habit of doing
things. The good way to do it.
Yeah, you know, your code is all formatted this way, and, you know, you know, so like Go has Go format, and Python we have pep8.py, and like just use pep8.py, you know, like, and I think there's some good lessons back and forth there. But the other thing I want to just kind of mention is like there's some things that are going to feel really awkward and weird when you're starting to learn Go.
Such as?
You know, so one is the error handling is kind of one example of that.
Okay.
You know,
and
there's a bunch of those throughout. Or, you know, you look at a library and it doesn't feel like there's enough code there to really do what you want to do. And I really encourage people to give the Go way a try, right? So give the error handling a shot before knocking it. Like actually really try to write some code and see how it affects your experience with the code, you know. And, you know, if you have some library that looks like it just can't possibly work, try it. And, like, I found over and over again that there was actually plenty of functionality there, and I was able to, you know, write the stuff I wanted to write. So I think that has kind of helped me from a design standpoint think about how little code can we have to make this really work.
Less. There was this talk that Rob Pike wrote, very good one. It's called Less is Exponentially More. So yeah, that's exactly that point of sometimes having a little less code is actually a good idea.
So
thank you very much for sharing your experience. So okay, so what could the Pythonista watching this video do next if they want to learn Go?
So that's easy. Go to tour.golang.org. We'll put the link up, and it's, you know, a web-based introduction walkthrough to the Go language that's interactive. You type Go programs, you hit a button and they run, and it takes you from the very beginning all the way up through concurrency exercises and everything else. So when you have a few hours, sit down and get started with that. I think it's very worthwhile and really helps. You can read about Go, but like a couple hours doing that, it will really internalize what it feels like to actually use Go.
Great. So, well, thank you very much for those pieces of advice.
Yep.
And thank you very much for watching. Bye-bye.
Take care.